بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فهو المهتد ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله يقول الحق تبارك وتعالى في كتابه الكريم يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون أما بعد فإن خير الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. My dear brothers, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. We have started, as you know, explaining the Aqeedah Al-Wassitiyyah of Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah. And we reached the phrase when he said, وَمِنْ قَوْلِهِ الْإِيمَانُ بِاللَّهِ وَمَلَائِكَتِهِ وَكُتُبِهِ وَرُسُلِهِ وَالْبَعْثِ بَعْدَ الْمَوْتِ وَالْقَدَرِ خَيْرِهِ وَشَرِّهِ. All these six words are the pillars of Iman. And same I said before, I said these kind of lectures should be interactive again. They should not be just delivering and you just listen. And we have defined what Iman means. I mean, can anybody help me out? So what, when I check about you guys, if you're understanding what Iman means. When you say I am a mu'min, remember, Islam and Iman are different, but they could be sometimes mean the same meaning. Every mu'min is a Muslim, but not every Muslim is a mu'min. Islam is for actions which is you do, like salah, shahada, zakah. These are the actions of that you see, al-zahir, al-a'mal al-zahir. These are actions of a Muslim. But Iman is for things which is in your heart. الخشية من الله التوكل على الله الإيمان بالله وملائكته وكتبه. We have not seen Allah سبحانه وتعالى, but we have seen His creation. We have not seen His angels, but we believe in them. We believe that we will be resurrected and we'll be questioned, and people will go to the hellfire or go to the paradise. These are pillars of Iman. So last time we explained what Iman of Allah means. Now we'll talk about al-imanu bil malaika. Okay, what we say malaika or angels, what angel means for you? What do you know about these creatures of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? We are created from mud, right? How about the angels? From light, nur. They were created from nur. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us some description of these of the angels in the Quran. There are so many. Actually, the hadith fil bayt al-ma'mur, every day 70,000 enters and they will not come back. Every day. أطت السماء وحق لها أن تأط ما من موضع أربع أصابع إلا وملك ساجد لله. The attat means it's like if you put a load in a truck or a camel and it becomes so shaky because of the load. Which means for us the number of angels are so many. Maybe we cannot count them as human beings, but Allah knows how many they are. So from this we know they are extremely so many. أطت السماء, even the heavens cannot carry them because there are so many making sujood to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they will enter the door of Bayt al-Ma'mur every day, 70,000 of them, and they will not come back. So from that we know how many they are. We cannot, they are countless maybe. Allah knows about the numbers, but we don't know. And we don't maybe have to know, but we have to believe they are so many. That's a must. Now, we know that they are created from nur or light. We know that they are so many. Now, we know also what? They are strong. شداد غلاظ. لا يعصون الله ما أمرهم ويفعلون ما يأمرون. They are very strong. In one of the description of Jibreel عليه السلام, he has 600 wings. They are so big. They are so strong. That's the description of the Quran. If we believe in the Quran, this is from the verses of the Quran. Allah has the way described them. They described them as they are very strong. جاعل الملائكة رسلا أولي أجنحة. That means what? They have bodies. They have figures. They have figures. That's what the Quran says. They have wings. That means you can maybe imagine them. But we have not seen them. We have not seen them. But they are bodies. Because the Quran says that. So, and also the other important description of them is that they obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They do not disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They will say, do whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asks them to do. لا يعصون الله ما أمرهم ويفعلون ما يأمرون. Always obedience. Human beings is otherwise. Allah gave them the choice to obey or not to obey. So this is our test as a human beings. This is a test for us that we have the choice to be a good slaves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or be a bad slaves. And that's the difference between us, the angels. Now, we don't know how many they are, but we have maybe a few names that we know from the Book of Allah and the Sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Like Jibreel. What Jibreel does, alayhi salam. He's in most case, I mean, what we know about him, he reveals the messages, conveys the message to the messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's what we know about him. We know Israfil. He's the one who will make the call in the hereafter. ينفخ في الصور. So people will be from the graves, they will be arrested, you know, they will come to the day of judgment. This is what we know from the Sunnah. Okay? We know Mikael. Also we know what he does. He does, he's responsible for the rain and plantation. That's what we know. That's all what we know. We know Malak al-Maut. قُلْ يَتَوَفَّاكُمْ مَلَكُ الْمَوْتِ الَّذِي وُكِّلَ بِكُمْ. Allah called him the king of death. He's the man or the angel who comes and takes the souls. So we know about this angel. We know also خازن النار. قَالُوا يَا مَالِكُ لِيَقْضِ عَلَيْنَا رَبُّكُ قَالَ إِنَّكُمْ مَاكِثُونَ. This angel will tell the souls to come out. Take us out of the hellfire. They said, no, you are staying for what you did in this dunya. They will ask him to, because he's responsible for the people of the hellfire. So this is basically what we know about the angels. It's a pillar of Iman that we have to believe in it. It's not something a matter of choice. It's part of our six pillars of Iman that we believe in it. We know we have some angels who write what we do. And they count what you do. And write it down. If you do good, they will write a good down. If you do bad, they will write it down. In the left and the right. These things what we know. Now, the Imam, the Shaykh said, وَمَلَائِكَتِهِ وَكُتُبِهِ. Now, the scriptures or the texts that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed, how many they are? Do we know? We know the Quran, Torah, Injil, Suhuf Musa, or some scholars say Suhuf Musa is the same as the Torah. It could be. Okay? Suhuf Ibrahim. Okay? الزبور لداود. Okay, so these are the ones we know. And we know that the Quran is Muhaymin, is the prevailing book and accepted after all. That's what we know. That the Quran is the last book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and it's not been changed and any distortion or anything happened to it. Allah made judgment إنا نحن نزلنا ذكر وإنا له لحافظون. Allah will, you know, protected from changing or alterations or anything. That's what Allah Subhanahu has promised. So the Quran, what we recite, is the same Quran that Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam recited. It's the same. So this is what we know about the messengers of Allah Subhanahu Wa Taala. But the messengers of Allah Subhanahu Wa Taala, wa kutubihi, these are all the only books we know. What we believe in them? We believe the Quran is the one we should follow. That's what you have to believe. And it's the last book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We also believe that Torah is the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but there were some changes to it. So we have to know that. So you know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed other books. Because he said, wa kutubihi, not one book, kutub means many. And Allah named some of them, Injil, Torah, they were mentioned in the Quran. Zabur was mentioned in the Quran. So we believe it was revealed to his messengers. Okay? طيب. نعم وكتبه ورسله. Now, do we know how many messengers and the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala were sent to mankind? The exact number nobody knows. But how about, there is also an important concept here, is what we call ulul azm, the one with the, not courage, only or irada or will, but they are the one who are strong and patient and have the will to stand for the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and deliver the message. And usually these messengers of Allah, the one Allah has given them or revealed to them a new sharia to deliver to mankind. These ones are Nuh, Ibrahim, Musa, Isa, and Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We say the ulil azm are five messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's actually mentioned in the Quran. شرع لكم من الدين ما وصى به نوحا. The other verse, وأخذنا من النبيين ميثاقهم ومنك ومن نوح وإبراهيم وموسى وعيسى ابن مريم وأخذنا منهم ميثاقا غليظا. In this Quran, Allah has mentioned these five. We call them the messengers. Actually, when the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم went to Isra and Mi'raj, in the day of judgment, people will come to Nuh to intercede for them. They will say to him, you are the first messenger of Allah. He will say, go to Ibrahim. He will send him to somebody else. Till they come to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and then he will intercede. So, an important also concept here is that we have to believe that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the last messenger. Anybody who believes there's a messenger or a prophet after the Prophet ﷺ is not considered Muslim. Nobody, even if he says La ilaha illallah Rasulullah, and he denies what Allah says in the Quran, that's basically he's saying that he is not a Muslim. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran said, Wa khatam al-Nabi. Muhammad is the last messenger. He is the last one, and another messenger of Allah will come to mankind after that. Muhammad is the last messenger. If any group says we have a prophet, we have a messenger, then you have to be careful with that. And why we say this is not a Muslim, even if he said Allah Muhammad Rasulullah, it's not enough, because he's denying what Allah is saying in the Quran. It's very important. When we say, I believe in the Quran is the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it means that I believe in everything in the Quran. You cannot take some and leave some. You have to believe in everything in it. Of course, the Quran have different verses or different methodology. Well, sometimes the Quran is what we call muhkam. The meaning is very clear. Sometimes the meaning is not easy to understand. There you need a scholar or sahabi to explain to you. So, muhkam, like when you say, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ وَاحَدْ مُحْكَمْ. It's a very simple word. It says Allah is one. But when you come to ahkam, things like that, where the scholars have to derive, when you come to mutashabih, when things describing the day of judgment, it becomes very unclear for you. You need to maybe ask a scholar to explain to you. Become something from ghaib. Again, the pillars of Iman are unseen things. Things that we don't know, we have not seen, but we ought to believe in it. And subhanAllah, we believe in it because we believe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is one, because Allah has sent us messengers and they delivered the message. They guided us to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they guided us to what will happen to us after death. And that's why we are going that route. Okay? The fifth pillar of Iman, wal-ba'th ba'd al-mawt. This is a very important concept that we Muslims, and actually most of the religions of that Allah subhanahu revealed to His messengers, like even Christianity and Judaism and others, like these religions, people of the book, they believe in the Day of Judgment in general, that they will be rewarded going to heaven and things like that. But we as Muslims believe is that people will go through the Day of Judgment, and people will be re-resurrected, and they will be judged, will be accountable for what they did in this dunya. When one of us dies, من كان آخر كلامه لا إله إلا الله دخل الجنة. That means who say لا إله إلا الله before he dies, he will go to Jannah, paradise, because he basically dies as a Muslim. So what happened after death? We have a long series. If we're gonna spend, we're gonna spend days on this subject. You know, people go out to the grave and they will be asked, and their good deeds in this dunya will be as a man, for him, a good looking man. And then when the day of judgment comes, they will resurrect from their graves. They will go to the mahshar, and then they will stand for 50,000 years. Then they will ask the go to the pond of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then they will go to Ard and so forth. There's so many incidents that happens. All of them after death. And they will cross the line, the Sirat. The ones who succeed, they will succeed. Who once drops, he will maybe a munafiq or a Muslim, the kuffar. Who dies as a kafir and does not believe in Allah and His Messenger. What we believe, Ahl Sunnah, that he will go to the hellfire right away. But the people who are munafiq, or the one who his deeds are more than his good deeds, the bad deeds are much more than his good deeds, he will be maybe crossing the Sirat, maybe he will drop down in the hellfire. He will maybe tortured for some time, and then he will be out after that, because he said La ilaha illallah one day. That's what the meaning, as Ahl Sunnah say, whoever say La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah in this dunya, even if his bad deeds exceeds his good deeds, he will end up in paradise. He will end up in paradise. That's why إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرُ أَن يُشْرَكَ بِهِ وَيَغْفِرُ مَا دُونَ ذَلِكَ لِمِنْ يَشَاءُ. Allah will forgive any sin, but the sin that does not forgive at all is shirk. And that's what we as Muslims differentiate between others. Without naming other religions or other ways of life, we believe we have to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even if that person is Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You cannot worship Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is shirk. This is the great sin in Islam. Inna dina inda Allah al-Islam. The religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Islam. Associating with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the biggest crime in Islam. It's a sin that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not forgive. And that's why we are teaching Aqeedah, because this is where you teach you, because this is the foundation. Day one we said this. Aqeedah is very important. Maybe you do ibadat, sometimes you make mistakes. You are maybe lazy. But if you have La ilaha illallah, it will protect you in the end. And things will be straightened. But you have the wrong faith, and you believe the grave will help you, then it's a disaster. If you believe somebody will intercede for you, this is a disaster. Somebody will give you healing? No. Or you believe Allah has a son? No. This is the shirk. This is the sin that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not forgive. Again, we'll go to the day of judgment. There are so many things happens in this day of judgment. Intercession of Sallam will end up making sujood to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he will say alhamd to Allah so many things. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will tell them, raise your head, Muhammad. Ask and I will give you. And make shafa'ah, intercede for anything, I will answer you. And so forth. These incidents that happens is all part of the ba'ath, part of the resurrection. Because this is the end. This is the last, what we call darul qarar. This dunya is just passing. This dunya is passing. In the end, you will go to hell, or somebody will go to hell, and somebody, a Muslim, will go to the paradise or Jannah. And that's our goal. That's why we are actually trying to learn our religion, to fulfill our aqeedah, to understand it very well, so that we can act upon this belief correctly. The last subject, or this last pillar of Iman, Al-Iman wal-Qadari khayrihi wa sharrih. Although we reached the 30 minutes, and this subject is a little bit delicate, because I want you to understand it. Maybe I'll leave it one halaqa by alone, by itself. You know Al-Qadr? Yeah. This concept may be a little bit difficult to understand, so we'll leave it for by itself alone. Because if we go into it, we're going to spend another 15 to maybe 20 minutes minimum on it. And it's sometimes people get confused with that concept. Although, it's very simple. Yani, because I don't like to give the impression that Islam is very difficult. Islam is a very easy religion. You believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you follow His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It's that simple. Whatever is authentic in the hadith, you do it. It's not authentic, you can leave it. The Quran is muhkam wa mutashabih. Allah tells us to pray, but how do we pray? The action of the prayer is mutashabih, maybe. Something we don't understand. Unless we go to the Sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then we understand how to pray. That's why our religion, the sources of our religion, are the Book of Allah and the Sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because you cannot understand the Quran alone. And some people say, I only follow the Quran. No. If you leave the Sunnah, you are committing a great crime. The Prophet ﷺ, مَنْ رَغِبَ عَنْ سُنَّةِ فَلَيْسَ مِنِّي. The Prophet ﷺ said, whoever leaves my Sunnah is not a follower of me. Allah says, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ فَاتَّبِعُونِي يُحْبِبْكُمُ اللَّهِ. If you say that you love Allah, follow Muhammad ﷺ. Allah will love you. So, anybody differentiate between Quran and Sunnah, he does not know his religion. Or he's doing this in purpose to mix their minds and confuse the people. Because if you read the Quran, all of the ahkam and the explanations, interpretations of this religion comes in the Sunnah. I conclude with Jazakum Allah khair. And if you have any comment or question, inshallah, we'll try our best to answer. Jazakum Allah khair.